knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
So far, we have discussed a number of olefination reactions, so let's present yet another widely used method, the Julia reaction, also called Julia-olefination. The reaction was first reported by French chemist Marc Julia in 1973 and consists of the addition of a sulfone carbanion to an aldehyde. This generates a beta-sulfonyl alcohol, which can be reduced in a number of ways to yield an olefin, usually in the E form. The first step is conceptually simple. When discussing the Romberg-Backlund olefination, we saw that sulfones easily form alpha carbanions when treated with base. In this case, the carbanion, which is the nucleophile, reacts with a carbonyl compound, the electrophile, to yield the primary adduct. Given this premise, we will spend the rest of the tutorial elucidating some of the different ways by which the beta-sulfonyl alcohol can be transformed into an olefin. In the original formulation of the reaction, the hydroxyl group is acylated, typically to the acetate, and the resulting beta-sulfonyl acetate is reduced to the olefin. Many reagents can be used, and the mechanism of the reduction depends on the reducing agent used. The most typical reagent is a sodium amalgam with mercury, and when this is used under basic conditions, the acetate group is eliminated via an E2, or more probably an E1CB mechanism involving prior formation of the carbanion alpha to the sulfone. This leads to the vinyl sulfone, usually as a mixture of E and Z isomers. One electron reduction with sodium leads to this radical anion, which loses the very good leaving group aryl sulfonate, leaving a vinyl radical, which is a rapidly isomerizing mixture of the E and Z radicals. The second one electron reduction gives a carbanion, which is then protonated by the alcohol solvent to yield a mixture of olefins in which the E isomer usually predominates. We will not discuss the rationale for the E selectivity because the Julia reaction is hardly ever run this way anymore. In 1991, Marc Julia's younger brother, Sylvester, also a chemist, reported an important modification of the Julia reaction, which eliminated the need for the reduction step. This extension is now called the modified Julia reaction, perhaps because referring to it as the Julia-Julia reaction may have seemed awkward, but the new procedure was definitely an important development. The sulfone utilized in this modification bears a benzothiazole group. The primary adduct bears a nucleophilic alkoxy group, which can attack in intramolecular fashion the C double bond N functionality, formerly an imine and therefore electrophilic on the carbon. The negative charge on the nitrogen is removed by the breakage of the better leaving group, in this case the sulfonate anion, as the CS bond is weaker than the CO bond. This fragmentation process, also referred to as the Smiles rearrangement, yields the alkyl sulfonate. This intermediate tends to lose SO2 gas, and breakage of the second CS bond is accompanied by formation of the double bond and elimination of this conjugate base of 2-hydroxybenzothiazole, which is a good leaving group. We will discuss the stereochemistry of this process in a moment. So this modification has an internal oxidative process where the oxygen of the alkoxide ends up being incorporated into the leaving group, which eliminates the need for a separate oxidative step. This principle has been extended to other heterocyclic systems, the most important one being the N-phenyl tetrazoleal system. This especially mild and smooth variant of the Julia reaction is called the Julia-Kocienski reaction. In this case, the conjugate base of 5-hydroxy-1-phenyl-tetrazole is the leaving group, and the principle is the same as in the modified Julia reaction. The oxidation is an internal process in which the Smiles rearrangement leads to loss of SO2 and expulsion of an especially good leaving group. Now on to the stereochemistry. This is a very difficult topic, which is currently still evolving, so we will merely discuss a simplified scheme that covers the most important concepts to keep in mind. The stereochemical outcome is set in the first step, meaning the formation of syn-A or anti-A, provided all other steps are stereospecific and irreversible. This is usually the case with aliphatic aldehydes and aliphatic sulfones, meaning that R1 and R2 are alkyl groups. So in this case, to control E and Z stereochemistry, one has to work with the transition states leading to syn-A and anti-A, given that in the case of alkyl groups here, the elimination on C to give the olefin is anti-paraplanar, which means anti-C gives E olefins and syn-C gives Z olefins. In this case, the identity of the metal is important, because the metal tends to be coordinated with the sulfone group and possibly the aldehyde oxygen. At the same time, solvents can promote or hinder this coordination according to their polarity. It is always difficult to predict which conditions will lead to which stereoisomer, but pragmatic screening can often lead to high preference for the E or Z olefin. As an example, we will showcase the synthesis of ambrutisin, a natural antifungal agent described by Professor Eric Jacobson at Harvard University. One of the key steps of the synthesis is a modified Julia olefination. It is interesting to observe how, by changing the base from sodium hexamethyl disilazide to its lithium counterpart, presumably promoting anion aggregation and optimizing the solvent from tetrahydrofuran to a mixture of dimethylformamide and dimethylpropylene urea, one can alter the selectivity from a very disappointing Z selectivity to a complete selectivity in favor of the desired E olefin. A firm rationale for the results is not available, and this highlights the empirical nature for much of organic synthesis. Two simple steps after the Julia reaction complete the synthesis of the natural product. Now let's go back to our scheme. If the first step is reversible, things begin to look a little different. Indeed, if R1 is benzyl and R2 is aryl, the addition of the anion to the aldehyde is reversible, and the equilibration is a fast process in relation to the subsequent steps. Now, what should decide the stereochemistry is which one of syn-A or anti-A undergo the Smiles rearrangement more quickly. Since anti-B contains an eclipsing interaction between R1 and R2 and is therefore less stable than syn-B, one would predict some preference for the Z olefin. However, this is usually not seen. Both experimental evidence and theoretical calculations show that while anti-A leads to the E olefin via the Smiles rearrangement, followed by the expected anti-paraplanar fragmentation, the syn-C diastereomer undergoes a syn-coplanar elimination, meaning it prefers a transition state in which the SO2 group and the hydroxybenzothiazole leaving group are coplanar, but leave from the same face of the molecule, which is a very unusual situation for 1-2 elimination reactions. This, of course, also leads to preferential E olefin formation, and indeed E olefin formation is typically favored when dealing with benzylic sulfones and especially aromatic aldehydes, which means reactions in which the first step is reversible. We should also briefly mention that the Julia reaction, when applied to ketones, leads to trisubstituted olefins, in which the stereochemical factors are very complex, but in which some measure of stereo control has been achieved. New mechanistic twists and synthetic applications of this fascinating reaction appear very frequently in the literature, and so it is important to keep in mind that this field, like many others in organic synthesis, is still evolving, and chemists will undoubtedly find new interesting facets of the Julia chemistry in the near future.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.